they become Mark.
Right, we're rolling. Hello, Brendan.
Hi, how are you?
We're here in Hollywood, I suppose. I was looking at, when I was looking through your book about the idea of Hollywood being the source of almost like nuclear fallout. Something happened here that then spread over the rest of the world. I wonder, do you remember the first time you came to Hollywood? How did you feel about that?
Well, I was wildly excited. I suppose the first time I came here would have been 77, I think. And I wanted to rush around like a tourist. And even then, everyone I met in Los Angeles said, oh, no, it's over.
Yeah.
It's been over a while. And I think it's true. And in those days, you could still go to places that you knew from having seen on film, and you could go to places where films you knew had been made, and the place was still the way it was. And that's much harder now. And there's much less going on here in the way of filmmaking because it's become so expensive a place to make films. I was told the last great time in filmmaking here in Los Angeles was the O.J. Simpson trial, because that was so huge. People from all over the world were coming, and they were hiring camera crews and sound crews and all that kind of thing. And it was the last great employment bonanza for filmmakers, which tells you a lot about what's happened to movie making. But of course, the word Hollywood lasts like, it's a word like Rome and Constantinople and Paris. There's the idea of a culture that has emanated from it. And that's still true, although the places where the culture is being made now are all over the world, certainly all over California too. But yeah, it's still there. And I still find Los Angeles nostalgic. We're talking in a bungalow at the Chateau Marmont where I think Nicholas Ray stayed when he was setting up Rebel Without a Cause. And I think that room behind you is probably the room in the famous photographs where the cast are reading the script. And I find that very appealing. And there's a historian in me that it gets to. And to think that we're that close to the making of things that I still regard as, you know, very important and valuable. Beyond that, there is the whole way in which the West of America, and America as a whole really, has built this idea of illusion and make-believe, which you can't trace and track down to anywhere in Los Angeles anymore, but it's what has been accomplished, you know. And you called it fallout, and that's a good thing in a way, because it's in the air, you can't see it, but it's probably pretty toxic, so you should breathe carefully.
Well, it's interesting that you say that it's toxic, because obviously, like, you fell under the spell of the movies at an early age, and it's defined your life, and the title of your latest book, the Big Screen and Movies and What They Did to Us.
Yeah.
But how do you feel about what they did to us? Is it a benign thing, or is it a toxic thing?
I have extremely mixed feelings about it. I think it's been wonderful, because I think that it came along just as the population was really taking off in geometric progression. It was a mass of people who needed some entertainment. God knows what would have happened politically in the world if they had not had it, you know. And first with film and then with television. It came along and it occupied basically the population. You know, what we don't realize is that there was a time when well over half the population went to the movies once a week. quite staggering by today's standards. And then even more, in even greater proportion, spent maybe 4 or 5 hours a day watching television. So that culture was vast. And it was educational, it was informative, it was entertaining, it was moving, it was funny. But it also, I think, set up the notion that the world is out there and we're going to put it on a screen for you and you're going to look at it henceforth on a screen. And you know that it's derived from reality, but equally you know you can't touch it, you can't get in there, you can't get into it, and you can't really affect it. And that has had enormous implications in detaching us and separating us from the reality of the world. To take just one example, it's why I think young people today believe that politics is futile. Politics is what the people on the screen decide is going to happen, and they carry it out, and they do it, and there's not a damn thing we can do except watch it. And whereas you could have hoped once upon a time that democracy would breed in people a sense of participation and action and being active, I think you have to face the fact now, and the screens have multiplied out of all proportion and beyond anything anyone ever dreamed possible, but now we really are a society of spectators. And we believe that our role is to watch. And if you say, well, what about immigration? Well, I can't do anything about it. What about global warming? Well, I don't know what they are going to do about global warming. You know, in my lifetime, people took to the streets and marched against nuclear weapons. And the idea of participation by young people in what you would call politics was a very big thing. Very hard nowadays to find people in college who are actively engaged in politics in any way. And I think it's because they believe that that action has become futile, that the world is on a course, probably a pretty bad course, and it's going, and there's nothing they can do to intervene in it. So they'll watch it. And it's in the nature and logic of television, I think, with its enormous appetite for disaster and crisis, that we will watch the end of the world on television. It will be the biggest ratings ever, you know. And in that sense, it's dark and gloomy and makes one pessimistic. But then I remember that as a child, I had the most fantastic entertainment. Using the word entertainment in the broadest sense, I mean, really drawing the spirit out of you, making you come alive, making you grow up in watching movies. And I still have it. There are still great movies being made. They're not being made in the way they once were, not as being made as regularly. But going to the movies can still be a terrific experience, so long as you can maintain going to them, because essentially now they're coming to us, and you know that's going to take over. You know that in your lifetime, certainly, you're not going to be able to go out to movies anymore. They will come to us in one form or another. You'll watch them on a screen that, as you get older, your eyesight can hardly see. You'll probably watch them on your thumbnail, or you'll watch them in a chip that is in your eye already, you know. It's all science fiction, and we know that today's science fiction will be with us in 5 years. And it's gloomy, but it's wildly exciting too. And that's why I have extremely mixed feelings about it. And I found myself slipping into a life in watching films and writing about them, talking about them, and even making them. And there's a part of me that says, oh, I should have been a doctor or something like that. But then I think there was something inside me that was so drawn by the fantasy of it and the for me, the movies were, that's what it will be like when you grow up, you know? And that's why I think movies are always for young people, because they offer this dreamscape that you can think you will grow into. And I think that's been part of the appeal since they began.
Well, that was an interesting thing I took from your book, that in a way they show you life, or I liked, there was a bit, I can't remember if it was from the radio series or the book, but about how movies kind of would show you how to smoke and how to look at the opposite sex and how to kiss, and that idea that maybe, not that movies invented kissing, but maybe they popularized it or made it more widespread.
Well, I think, I mean, literally, I think teenagers, or at whatever age people now decide they want to kiss, feel that urge, they really, in a way, don't know how to do it, and they can make a physical mess of it. And the movies made kissing elegant, and they made it, in a way, clean, if you know what I mean. And yes, they taught you to do that. They taught you to smoke. They taught you to walk across a room. Most young people are in terror of walking across a room while other people are watching. They hunch up and they become horrified. And a large part of what makes movies wonderful is the way people move. If you think of Humphrey Bogart, you see him walking across a room, which sounds like a ridiculously simple thing. But if you think of the accumulated films Bogart made, the way he walked across rooms is at the heart of it, you know. Mm. He was a damn cool walker. And they taught you how to talk. Now, movies are not as interested in talk now as they were once upon a time, but witty, smart talk back and forth between people, that was in movies once. They taught you how to look. I mean, the whole notion of what it is to be good looking and what good looking means. There's no book where you can look up good looking. But in the movies, good looking is a certain kind of appearance, but it's also good in the sense of virtuous too. Because fundamentally in the movies, still to this day, good looking people are good people. Now, in life, we don't believe that. We don't act upon it. We know that sometimes the ugliest, plainest people, although we're not allowed to use a word like ugly anymore, but you know, homely, sometimes they're the most intelligent, and sometimes they're the people who maybe should be president or something like that. But the movies really said, oh, if you look like Tyrone Power, it means you're as good as good can be. Mm. And it's not true. But it was an enormously persuasive myth. And we're still living with it in lots of ways. We're still living in a world in which people buy magazines telling them how to look. And the magazines are really extensions of the movies, which told you how to look. What clothes to wear. One of the great things about the films of the Depression, I think it's one of the bravest things Hollywood ever did, in the years of the Depression, and the Depression was economically terrible, savage, much worse than what we've lived through in the last few years. People wore beautiful clothes. And, you know, realistically, it was a defiance. It was saying, well, you know, people can't afford clothes like that. And Hollywood, the system said, I don't care. They can dream about it. Mm-hmm. And the dream worked. And people went to the movies in those years. And in part, it was to see men and women in fabulous clothes doing cool things. They were like advertisements for life. Long before commercials came to television, they were like advertisements.
And that makes me interested in what then happened with, I believe the production code came in. Like you're saying, they were given advertisements for life, but then it seemed that there was a decision that maybe they weren't pushing people in the correct moral direction, and so things had to be clamped down a little bit. I wonder if you could tell me a little bit about that.
Well, it's a fascinating historical thing, but you know, from the beginning, there had been people in academia, in education, in the churches, in government, who were very alarmed about the movies because they thought, you're feeding poor people, and it was originally a medium for poor people, you're feeding poor people dreams. that reality cannot live up to. That's dangerous. Dangerous in the way of, you know, going on the streets and saying, everyone in this society should be equal and all property should be shared. Dangerous in that kind of way, the political implications. So the authorities in the society were afraid of the movies. They still are. And the people who ran the business, who for the most part were impoverished East European Jews who had come to this country, done very, very well, but were very afraid of their newfound wealth and status being taken away from them. They were very frightened that problems in society would be blamed on the movies. And in the 1920s, when real money started to be made in the movies, there were many instances of young people in the movies, basically young, uneducated people making a fortune and behaving foolishly, which, yeah. You give young people money, it tends to happen, you know. There were drug cases, there were murders, there was a lot of bad stuff. I don't know that there was any more bad stuff then than there is now, but it got a lot of publicity. And the movie business said, we've got to police ourselves. Otherwise, the state may intervene and police us. So really, the code and the attempt to clean up the American picture came from the industry itself in an attempt to forestall outside forces taking over. And it was regrettable in every way, I think, except that in the long term, it didn't really matter, because the movies evolved a code very quickly in which if two people kissed, the audience knew what was going to happen 10 seconds later. You faded out.
Yeah.
But the audience were not fools. They could understand. So that the imperative and the lure of desire carried on regardless. But the movies made themselves a little less grown up. Yeah, at that time.
Yeah,
because
I know.
And of course, it was not until the 60s, really, that code broke down.
Because I know that they've kind of reissued a lot of those pre-code films now.
Right.
And they are pretty amazing, actually. Well, look, I suppose it's just that thing. You don't think that sex or you don't think it was invented in the 60s, but it's still quite impressive to see it happening.
It is, but it's not just sex either. It's sort of it's the corruption in criminal organizations, that kind of thing. It's the Godfather 40 years before its time. It's the idea that, you know, this is actually a crooked society. And believe me, the people who ran Hollywood knew that because they were very close to the people who ran crime. So there were a lot of things like that that were being just pushed down by the code, by censorship. But then in the 60s, so much was going on in society in general that films just gave in, really. And censorship was abandoned, virtually, you know.
You mentioned desire in that last answer, and that I'm interested in that, which you touch upon a lot in your writing, this idea that maybe the movies bring something out of people that make them feel entitled to desire, which
yes.
Maybe they wouldn't do in
well, I think this is why the movies have worked all over the world, but there was a long time in which America was the model for the way movies should be. And this is a country that honestly believes in an impossibility, which is if you come here, everything will be all right. Now, you don't have to be more than a first grade mathematician, sociologist to know that that can't be, because if everyone's all right, everyone's poor. But it's based upon the notion that if you come to America, everything that you wanted to escape in Europe or wherever, Asia now, Africa, will fall away and you will be fulfilled and you'll be happy. Happiness is in the language upon which this country was founded. And the movies are a manifestation of a realizable desire. And I think that it's still there. It's still there in advertising. It's still there in television. And for decades, people went to see futures for themselves. They were impossible. And the futures were actually achieved by so tiny a portion of the audience, it was absurd. But this is where the real lives of the movie stars and the moguls are so important, because someone like Louis B. Mayer could say, look, I was hauling scrap iron in Nova Scotia just a few years ago, and now I am the man with the highest salary in America. It can be done. And, you know, Clark Gable, and anyone you want to pick, they were demonstrations that this transition, this transformation, this reinvention of yourself is possible. And it worked. And I think it is only in very modern times that Americans at large have begun to see that the dream doesn't work. And they're deeply troubled by it. And that's why this country is in such chaos and it's so uncertain where it's going to go. But that dream worked. And I think the movies kept it alive. I think the movies were a mass medium that ensured a certain kind of calm and order and common aspiration, because they said to people, your desires can work. Big thing to say.
Yeah.
Communism tried to say that to people and it fell apart, you know. And something like that is happening now here.
In that the belief system.
People are having to face the fact that their desires are not going to be fulfilled. And weren't they idiots ever to think it? So there's disillusion and there's resentment and there's anger. It hasn't yet taken any active form, and it may not. And there we get back to what I was talking about, the way in which people have distanced reality through the screen, you know. And the technology of screens may turn us into sort of puppets in a way. But the great thing in the movies, the reason I went to the movies, I'm sure it's the reason you went to the movies, was to see wonderful people and to imagine that you might be them. You might be as brave as the guys and you might have the women or whatever sexual arrangement you care to offer, you know. But yeah, you went to see Lassie films because, oh God, how great to have a dog as wonderful as that, you know.
Yeah.
How wonderful to have a kitchen, the size of the kitchens on screen. Most people in this country had kitchens that are too small. They still have kitchens that are too small. But the kitchens in movies, you can play, you can go bowling in them nearly, you know. That's a great dream. So it's there in decor, it's there in clothes, it's there in the stories. It's in all those things. And it's in the good-looking people.
Yeah, I suppose that's what I'm trying to work out in this. I don't know if I'll get to it, but this idea of whether the appetite that has been stoked by cinema and also TV, which maybe we'll discuss in a while, is a good thing or a bad thing. In terms of maybe it gives people false expectations of life, thinking that life will have a plot and will have lots of incident in it.
Well, you know, I mean, you've got to take the very large historical view. And it's no accident that this thing we're talking about, cinema, movies, begins really, overlaps with the loss of religious faith. Now, religious faith said to millions of people, don't worry, I know you're having a shitty life and it's terrible and you have no food, you have no money, and the baron's going to come around and rape your daughters and take you off and, you know, treat you terribly. But don't worry, God knows, God is watching, and you'll be okay. At the end of it all, your record as being a good person, it's in the book. And you can tell from the way I describe it that I never quite believed in it. But billions of people took it for granted. It it lapsed for many, many reasons, too complicated to get in. But movies do come along as a popular fiction that essentially everybody can go to. You know, you think of Charlie Chaplin. Virtually everyone in the world saw Charlie Chaplin. Now really, apart from breathing and eating and sleeping and a few other physical actions we can think of, what had everyone in the world done before Charlie Chaplin, you know? You could take the image of Chaplin all over the world and everybody smiled. The potential in that was enormous. I think it drove Chaplin himself mad. But it was in the medium, it was in the technology, and it was a myth. And if you think religion is a myth, and I do, then it was a myth that replaced the loss of church faith. It was a different kind of faith. And commercials, television commercials, carried it on for a while, and television as a whole. But really now, we're at a point where the myths have been blown apart. They've been scattered. And what happens next is fascinating, I think, you know.
Mm. I can't say that I know it myself, but...
No one does. And I think there are a lot of people who believe quite seriously, quite calmly, the world's going to end. And you know, the only real anxiety of that is if you have children, because I can face the world ending because my world's going to end soon enough anyway. But for my children, your children, that's a much harder future to bear because you don't want them to be exposed to that. But I think a lot of people do believe that's going to happen. Whereas I don't think many people believe that things, meaning our relationship with technology and our economic resources, that those things are going to get better. Mm. It's very hard to look at those problems and think, oh, we're going to work them out, you know. We're running short of water. Well, okay, we'll take the salt out of the oceans. Now, maybe we can do it, but we have so many of those problems that it's really difficult to think that we're going to deal with them, I think.
Yeah, that's slightly depressing.
Well, I'm sorry. Everyone says Los Angeles is slightly depressing.
So that another thing that I've been interested in is, given you know the all pervasive nature of the movies.
Yes.
And although, as you're saying, they probably peaked and their influence is not as strong as it was, but
right.
Still. The way that images are put together and the way that films work, that stuff was formulated pretty early on,
yes,
wasn't it?
And the language in film.
Yeah, and I would like to talk to you about that, about how... Because I like... Well, I'm interested in that because you kind of grow up watching TV, watching films. You absorb this language without really thinking about it, but somebody had to kind of say, oh, you know, somebody had to invent a close-up,
yes,
or something like that, and I'm interested in...
Yes.
What you can tell me about how that vocabulary got...
Well, I think that it was staggeringly exciting. And, you know, there aren't really that many people left. There's really no one left from that generation. But if you had ever talked to them, they would say it was just amazingly exciting. Someone like Griffith would make a couple of short films a week. You know, I mean, the learning curve was just staggering. It's like a writer writing a couple of stories a week. You're gonna learn so much about writing. And yes, all over the world, and it did happen all over the world, people learned that you didn't just have to set the camera up and let action happen in front of it as if it were a stage play. You could do that. And there are some very good films made like that. But you could say at a certain moment, oh, don't you want to see what he's thinking? Which you can't really see in the theater, unless he thinks in a very broad, overdramatic way. But let's cut in, let's go to a close-up. And of course, once upon a time, audiences were troubled by close-ups because they thought you were cutting the body apart. They learned very fast, but all over the world, people learned that you can vary the position the camera's in. And once you've got several shots, once you've got two people talking and you've got 10 different shots to cover their conversation, then you're into the game called editing, where you'd say, well, what order are we going to put them in, you know? And if we put a different order, it changes the meaning. Now, in Russia, above all, there was an immense amount of exploration and theorization about the nature of editing and montage, you know, experiments where the same shot was put next to something or to something else, and the meaning changed. Because people watch films so that they are searching for meaning. When I was in film school, I hope you've got time for this little story. I was in the cutting room one day, and the cutting room in this film school, there were maybe 20 different films being made, and there was a great bin in the middle of the room where the cuts, things that had been cut out of a film, the odd ends, were thrown. And I started pulling them out and splicing them together. I didn't look at them. I didn't even wait to look at what the shot was of, much less judge, does it fit? I just pulled them out and I just spliced lengths of celluloid together, one after the other. And in an hour, I had about a 20-minute film, you know? So I took it down to the theater where there was some students watching, I don't know what they were watching, and I put it on and I ran it. And the splices held, that's what you're always hoping when you're a film student, the splices held. I didn't even look at the film because I was just trying to coax it through the projector. And I went into the theater, and the kids there in the theater were arguing about what the film meant. I put no meaning into it. Mm. It was a pure technical exercise. But you cannot show film to people without them beginning to try to explain it. It's a great natural response of curiosity and the way the brain works, you know. And when people discovered that what seemed like the proper order for shots was one thing, but you could play with the proper order, and maybe you could jump from one sequence to another. So you take a film like Magnolia, say, to come much more up to date. You've got several stories in Los Angeles going on, and you cut them back and forth. Now you do it with a sense of timing and everything, but you're not quite sure how one story reflects on the other. But the audience watching the film feels it. They begin to put it into the film from themselves. And, you know, film has always in that way been interactive. The audience sees things, and the age in which the first people were doing that for the first time, which is sort of 1905 to, let's say, the coming of sound, you know, amazingly exciting time. To drop a name, Lillian Gish, who is the pioneer generation, once said to me, "You never know what a film really means unless you see it on its opening day." Mm-hmm. In other words, there is a moment when no one knows what a film is and they see it and they love it or they hate it. But the historical reaction, the place of that film, falls into place straight away. It happens now economically. You open a film Friday night. The people behind the film are studying what's happening in the theaters all over the country because the future of the film is being determined. Do they laugh in the right place or not? And you've either got a hit or you haven't. And you know it that Friday night. And there are people in the business who will tell you Saturday morning, forget that film, it's over. This film, get ready, this is coming in, you know. I think that was an extraordinary time. Because you were making the first films ever made. I mean, can you imagine making Birth of a Nation? It's an unspeakable film in terms of what it's about. But Griffith says, I'm going to make the bus to sit there for 3.5 hours. And I'm going to tell several stories, and I'm going to put them all together, and it's going to be beautiful and majestic. And it was. And people went mad, you know. Wild, exciting time. Never been like that again, quite. There have been great times and great days, but I think that first generation discovering it, it was amazing. It's the way kids are discovering video and YouTube. Mm. I mean, why does this kid who just shot up Santa Barbara, we're talking years ago compared to when this will ever get out, but that kid makes a video. Now, this kid is desperately troubled. He's insane. He's disturbed. But he makes a video, and it's actually a pretty good video if you've seen it.
I haven't seen it.
It's amazing. Mm. And, you know, he knows enough about film to know how to make a video. And it's like a scene from a movie. Now, he probably knows he's going to kill himself within a few hours. It's desperate. Depressing is not the word. But I don't think that kid had ever been to film school. Mm. But it's in his blood. He knows how to do it.
Well, that's the thing. It is in our blood now, and that's I absorbed it from... Actually, before I get into this, have you still got that film that you, where you edited all the...
No, no, I'm afraid not. Anyone can make one like that.
I absorbed stuff through TV.
Yes.
And that's it. It does get into DNA. I remember, you know, watching the TV and... Well, I didn't think it as a, at the time, but... When I've tried to analyse it in later life, I kind of think, in a way, I may have taken more notice of the TV than I did of my parents, because parents I looked at, I thought, well, you know, they're like me, but just a bit bigger. TV, where are those pictures coming from? You know, there's this box, and you press a button, and then suddenly these things happen.
And you know, I mean, the fact of the matter is, if you're average, and I'm not accusing you of being average, but you know, we probably are more than we'd like to be, you probably grew up watching 5 hours a day. Mm. Now, I bet you didn't spend 5 hours talking to your parents. I bet you didn't spend 5 hours reading a book, or even listening to music in your case. Mm. 5 hours a day. Now, maybe you weren't always watching. You were there when it was on. And that's a very important thing about television. You don't actually have to watch it, you're just there when it's on. It's an extraordinary amount of input, you know. It's so much greater than people were getting in the movies. Some people went to the movies twice a week. Let's say, at the best, that's 6 hours in front of a movie screen. Now it's 5 hours a day. And also, think of that great moment when the remote comes along. Now, you and I were born in England and raised in England, where the number of channels you could watch was always pretty few. And a lot of the programs were very, very staid and old-fashioned and very orderly, you know, and procedural. But the remote, you could jazz the whole game up with the remote just by clicking, clicking, clicking. It's like an editing experiment. It's like a Russian editing experiment, going from one thing to another. You don't know what they'll be, but you suddenly make something like jazz, like rock, like poetry out of this medium that is basically very old-fashioned. And now television is sort of catching up to that world. They know we don't watch in the same sort of way. It was a very interesting process, because when you go to the movies, people did watch. Everything about the medium and its circumstances was built on concentration. Television is anti-concentration. And that's not a good thing, because, you know, we like kids to concentrate. Mm. But it's happened. It's inevitable. And you now have a medium that is saying, you don't have to concentrate. You want to go to the bathroom? Go to the bathroom. You want to take a phone call? Take a phone call. We'll be here when you come back. You know, it's ongoing. It's like the light. We're faithful. You turn us on, we'll stay on till you turn us off, and you can watch what you like. Now, if the bomb happens to go off down the end of the street, we're going to cover it, so you can watch that. But if it's Question Time or Come Dancing or, you know, or snooker, endless snooker, well, you know, you can take a little bit here and there. It's a quite different sense of attention. Enormously important. If you're a teacher, And if you've been a teacher through the period where that change occurred, you know what it's done to the attention of young people. Fascinating.
I wonder whether it's, I mean, we've talked about what's coming next with the, how do you feel about, you know, internet and stuff like that? Do you think that, because in a way TV's kind of on the wane now, I think.
Oh, definitely. You know, TV's over.
Yeah.
Just the way we were talking about filming over, TV's over. Yes. Network TV. Do you remember what networks were? You know, I mean, gone. Yeah, it's changing. Look, I'm too old to bother now about making moral judgments about it.
Yeah.
It's happening. It's my job simply to try and observe it and to describe what is happening. I don't know where it's going. I have an instinct that says it's not terribly good, but, you know, I don't know. It's also wildly exciting, I think.
In one way, it's like, it's not as passive as TV, is it? I mean, it's like you decide what you're going to search
absolutely.
For, look for.
Absolutely, yeah. And, you know, this guy, Elliot Roger, I think it's the name, who shot up Santa Barbara just a few days ago. It's an appalling case. And there are so many things about it that you can be horrified. The fact that he had the guns, the fact that he was driving around the city in a BMW. He's 22, he has no job, but he's got a BMW. You know, how that kind of thing occurs, I don't know. But the video he shot is the one sophisticated thing about his existence, as far as I can see. And it's amazing. And I think that it bears looking at closely and us trying to understand the process, you know, because there are extraordinary things coming in that medium.
I was interested in what you say about whenever anybody watches something, instantly they're looking for meaning.
Yes.
And in the way that maybe when motion pictures first started off, I'm interested in that thing of that maybe they kind of stirred something in people that they might not even have been aware that they had. So in some ways it kind of amplified people, stirred some kind of mythic appetite inside.
There are hugely positive things. Not least, something we haven't talked about. Suppose you're in that very first generation, you're going to the Nickelodeon in 1905, and they would show anything they could get their hands on in the Nickelodeon, and there might be little story films, but they might just show you a couple of minutes of what the pyramids look like in Egypt. Wow! That's what the pyramids look like. You know, I mean, our curiosity about how things look like. And there could be a shot of the pyramids, and there could be a few human figures in the foreground. And you can tell just from that one shot that those figures are desperately poor in a way that maybe no one is as poor in Europe. And you suddenly realize, God, there are countries out there that are far worse off than we are, and yet they have these huge, amazing, beautiful monuments to their own past. The inevitable sense of history is extraordinary. They showed you wild animals. You know, they would go and photograph a tiger walking through the jungle. Well, zoos existed. But, you know, zoos are pretty tatty affairs, and the tigers get very depressed. But this is a tiger being a tiger. And just supplying people with basic visual information about what the world is like, what experience is like. It's like when men landed on the moon, and these very rough, ragged TV pictures, you know, it made you think that's what the surface of the moon is actually like. And I think those things are amazing. When Fukushima occurred, there were shots of the tidal wave coming in and just picking up 100 parked cars and just as if they were ping pong balls, sending them flowing down a river. It's horrifying if it's your car. There were plenty of terrible things going on in Fukushima, but it's dazzling, you know, to see what that looks like. If and when the waters come up and rise, what will it look like? That's why horror films, disaster films, are so appealing, because people want to get an early look. And what
the sneak peek.
Yeah. And what the film industry and special effects and computer generation can make of it is fascinating to our curiosity, you know. But if it's the real thing, you know, amazing.
Well, that was a bit that I picked up on in your writing, that you would, in a way, bemoaning the fact that people aren't, just to see something in motion isn't enough anymore. That
just,
like people
just
become
to
kind of, just to see something in motion,
yes,
isn't enough anymore. It's like people have fallen out of love with the real world.
They're blasé about it. They take it for granted. And when I was teaching, I would sometimes run a film backwards. Because, you know, people have not often seen reverse motion. And reverse motion is amazingly beautiful. It's funny. It's touching. It changes your whole sense of physical reality. But it's a very good way of saying to people, now, do you realize how forward motion once looked every bit as fresh and exciting as that? We've got used to it. You know, we see, I can see every soccer game in the Premiership played over a weekend here in America. And I have to remember the first time I ever saw television coverage of soccer back in England. And it was just so wonderful to see a game. And now you take it for granted. And people are like that. It's totally natural that we digest things, we absorb them, and we pass on. And of course, there is a great pressure, always has been, on the people making films for us to show us something we've never seen before. And that's why special effects have become so enticing, because you could go beyond reality.
But in a way, does it lead to a kind of a... maybe some form of contempt for reality. That, like, you know, in the way movies improved on things, people looked better, things looked more inviting.
You see, I think there is that danger. I think that if you show people wilder and wilder things that only the computer can achieve, you are departing further and further from the miracle in photography. Of, I can show you something that happened once. You know that moment in Chris Marker's film, La Jetée, where the face moves? There's just a little passage of real time in it. It's so enchanting, it's so magical. And I have said before, I will say again for you, in an age of mass special effects, and some of them are dazzling, some of them are incredibly expensive, I still think the most special effect the movies can give you is to show you a face when the mind behind the face is changing, when some idea or some experience or some encounter is affecting the person deeply. I still believe in that. And you know, that's something that actors do with their faces. Real people can do it. But it's still something very simple. Any film student can do it, you know. And I still think that that's at the heart of what movies are about. When I see a film, say, like Locke. Have you seen Locke? But you know what Locke is?
I've heard of it.
It's Tom Hardy in a car one night, 90 minutes, continuous time. And you're looking at his face, really, all the time. Occasionally the film cuts away and shows the highway, but basically it's his face. It's a fabulous film. And it's really what this guy is going through. He has a series of ordeals and problems that he faces.
Don't tell me the end.
I'm not going to tell you anything about it beyond that.
I feel like I should...
It's his face. And he's a good actor. It's a good face, but he's well filmed. But it's the trust in the concept that if I show you a face in stress, I can move you. That's, I think, still vital to good movie making. One of the things that's amazing in this video of this kid in Santa Barbara is just his face. Mm. He's talking to the camera in his car. He's sitting in his car talking to the camera, and he's saying what he's going to do and why he's going to do it. And you are terrified, and you know it's ghastly. But you see his face, and you see what it means to him. Can't beat it.
But that's probably something that he's learned, isn't it, from watching films?
It's without question.
Like, it's like
he's... Without question, he has learned how you look at faces from the movies. Yes. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. And you go back to the close-up, which was this extraordinary invention, but it's the beginnings of that kind of self-consciousness. Yeah. Yeah.
And do you want to have a rest for a bit? Shall we have a bit of a break?
I wouldn't mind a drink of water.
Yeah, let's have a...
Yeah.
I need to go to the bathroom.
Well, then you should do that.
Yeah. Are you comfortable there as well?
I'm fine.
Is that all right?
Just thinking yourself into the part. Mm. Very tough. Tough. Yeah. Yeah.
And we were talking about, you know, films' effect on people's lives.
Yes.
In some ways, maybe taking the place of their lives. And I wanted to pick your brains here. One thing that I've always found appealing is that thing where people kind of break the fourth wall, where a person, say somebody in the audience becomes part of the film, or say like in The Purple Rose of Cairo, where the
yes.
characters
yes.
come down from yes. from the screen into real life.
Yes.
I don't know if you, do you know the first example of that happening?
Well, I don't know that it's the first, but there is a Buster Keaton film called Sherlock Jr., where he's a projectionist and he goes into the screen. And it's one of the first I can think of like that. He was a genius, and it's beautifully done physically, but it's also one of those movies that says to the audience, look, I know that's what you're thinking of doing. I know you feel that. And it can go both ways. The movement can go both ways. But there aren't that many hard examples of it, but there's a Godard film, Les Carabiniers, where a guy sees a woman in a bath in a movie, and he thinks he will get into the bath with her. And in fact, all he does is tear the screen to pieces, and the image just plays on him, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're very eloquent, those scenes. They say a lot about the medium, I think. And Purple Rose of Cairo is I think it's one of Woody Allen's most interesting films. Very touching, that whole passage.
I suppose it's that thing that you think, as you say, you know, that maybe films filled that God-shaped hole.
Yes.
At that point, and it's like it's the equivalent of going to heaven, isn't it? You become part
yeah,
of the.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, as television developed, particularly with sort of game shows and reality shows, the whole notion of getting someone in the audience to come on down, to go onto the stage and to be a contestant and to be part of the action, that has terrific appeal for the audience, I think, you know. People want to be on television, you find nowadays. It's a pressing thing, I think, you know. Yeah, yeah. And of course, kids use their smartphones to film each other all the time. It's amazing, you know. They're not doing anything in particular, they're just being. But they love to take images of each other. And it's the same sort of impulse, I think.
Can you pinpoint a particular film or a particular experience that was like, you know, when the movies first kind of cast a spell on you?
On me personally?
Yeah.
The plane, yeah. Sure.
Well, you don't need to hear my question.
I know, but just the beginning of your response.
Okay.
We're clear.
Should I just answer?
I was asking you if there was a particular film or a particular moment when you realised that was it.
It came right at the start. I think the first film I saw was Olivier's Henry V. Mm. And I was taken to it when I was 4, and of course, didn't understand a word. But I loved the Knights on Horseback part of the film. So when it got to the battle, I sort of sat up and took notice. They stopped talking these Shakespearean speeches. And then something that terrified me happened. There is a moment in Henry V where the French attack the English camp and they murder page boys while they're sleeping. And they set fire to the camp. And I believed that I had seen these boys' faces on fire. Mm. And I screamed. And I had to be taken out of the theater. This plane's out to get us.
It's all right, it'll be gone.
Yeah. So I'll go back a bit. I thought I had seen these boys on fire. And I screamed, and I had to be taken out of the theater by my father, who was very upset because he wasn't going to see the end of the film. And I said, those boys were on fire. And they said, no, of course they weren't on fire. Don't be silly. They wouldn't show you that on a film. Years later, I have to see Henry V for school, Shakespeare, you know. Mm. And it's the first time I've seen the film since that first time. And I think, oh, okay, I'll find out. And I know enough by then, I'm 14 or 15, to see that what you've actually got is a dissolve. You've got a shot of the boys, and you've got a shot of flames. And one is superimposed on the other. Standard device, particularly for that time, of two images together. And I see, of course the boys weren't on fire. You're just made to think the boys are on fire, you see. Mm. So that passes. Decades later, we're into the age of video. I'm with a son who is like 3 or 4. And he is watching a VHS of Henry V in the next door room while I'm working. And he watches Henry V because he likes the Knights on Horseback. But he comes running into the room crying, saying, Daddy, I've seen boys on fire. And the lesson of this is that when you're young, you don't know enough to distinguish the realities that are being used in a film. And, you know, I was terrified, but I was hooked, totally hooked. And I just thought what was happening on screen was magical, dangerous, because I was frightened. And I was frightened by a lot of early films I saw. I believed in their reality so much that when it became suspenseful and frightening, it was more than I could take. I'm still edgy about frightening films, you know, I still feel them. But that was really what hooked. The moment when I sort of knew I wanted to see the film over and over again, I saw Red River. I would have been about 7 or 8. And the film ended. And I was with my aunt. She had taken me to see the film. And she said, oh, okay, now we have to go shopping. And I said, no, I'm not going shopping. I want to see the film again. And of course, those were the days when a film played continuously.
Yeah, yeah.
It was about a 5-minute break, then they played it again. And I argued her into letting me stay. And she would go shopping and she'd pick me up when it was over. But I saw the film twice, straight through. I just did not want to go away from the film, if you know what I mean. Mm. It was a sort of something passionate. It was like being with a person. You didn't want it to end, you know. So those are two of the moments I could think of very early. Yeah.
And it's interesting, you know, you're saying about this thing of being terrified by the Henry V. And do you think that was part of the appeal as well? That
yes.
Yeah.
Yes. I think the fear factor was big. And although, as I say, I'm not crazy about really frightening films, I can't resist them either, you know. I saw as a teenager Clouzot's version of The Fiends. Do you know that? Diabolique. It's been made several times. And there's a moment in that film where the man who was supposedly dead is discovered in a bath full of water, drowned, except that he gets up. That terrified me for ages. The police are not coming.
The police are coming to, yes. You're safe.
We're never safe. I lived in a big old house in South London, and one of my jobs was to go down to the coal cellar in a basement, obviously, and fill a bucket up with coal to bring it upstairs to have fires with. And I did not like going down there in the dark. And I used to think of that scene from The Fiends every time I went down for like 6 months, really held me and gripped me, you know. Yeah, I think that, you know, going into the movies and the lights go down and the screen comes alive and you don't know what it's going to show you, there is a basic fear factor in there. And you know, once you get accustomed to films, that you can be sailing along and you can be watching Marilyn Monroe having a great time, but the image can cut quicker than you can close your eyes to something horrifying. That didn't happen in her films, but you know what I'm saying. The medium can do that, and you know that. It's sort of like Psycho. It's all of a sudden, you're in the shower, and a figure can appear through the curtain with a knife raised. And that has always worked in films, you know. And kids love to be frightened. They'll tell you they don't. Oh, I couldn't stand that. Oh, show it to me again. It's a terrific impulse in us, I think.
And once you've seen something, you can't unsee it, can you?
That's right. You try forgetting some of those moments, you know. Try forgetting the moment in Alien where John Hurt's chest cavity breaks apart and the crab, a very tender crab compared with what's coming later in the film, scuttles across the room. Very frightening.
But it seems we're touching on that there, something that's interesting, the fact that maybe films kind of, well, images, because they're not verbal, they're kind of reaching into something quite primal inside human beings. So you talk about this kind of primal fear, this fear of the dark is like a, I guess going back to in a cave, you know.
Yes.
It's a fear of the unknown, the fear of the dark.
And, yeah. Yeah, well, it's so true, and the people who are good at it, they know it either instinctively or because they've worked it out, but in Hitchcock, for instance, every time anyone starts to climb a staircase, they're in trouble in Hitchcock. They're vulnerable. Now, you know, we're all vulnerable on a staircase. You can fall. You could break your neck on a staircase without anything happening. But usually in Hitchcock, something dire happens on a staircase. And he's got that insight into things we fear. We've all got a knife in our kitchen. And it's only if you look at it very closely and feel its edge that you say, oh, that, I could kill someone with that. Well, they could kill me, you know. Now, Hitchcock knows that, and he's very good at drawing upon that kind of thing. It's primitive, it's primal, and it's there all the time. Yeah,
yeah, and with and I'm wondering whether that was the first time that, I mean, maybe that was the thrill of the early movies, that that was the first time that people had really been able to delve into that stuff and bring it alive, you know, play with those kind of...
Oh, I think so. Images. I think that's a big part of the excitement. And because it's it seems so incredibly real, but it's not. It's like a dream. And we all know that sensation of being a helpless onlooker at something very disturbing. We may not be able to explain why it's disturbing, but that has always been there in the movies, you know. And the most real things, when you put them up on a screen, they become metaphors for themselves. They have a greater meaning. And there, you get it the way people are always looking at the inner meaning.
And so they're looking inside themselves, basically.
They are. I think so. And I think that, I mean, once again, you have to sort of look at history. The year the Lumiere brothers first showed moving film to an audience, I think I'm right in this, I might be a year or two off, it's the year Freud published The Interpretation of Dreams. It's amazing the things that are going on in the culture at the same time, at totally different levels, but they are about the same sort of experience.
So, because that also interests me, that maybe the invention of the motion picture was kind of like somebody opening a Pandora's box and this stuff flying out.
Oh, totally out of our control. Mm. Yes, yes, totally out of our control. Another interesting thing is that when Edison did his work towards film, and Edison was really the great pioneer inventor, he had a system, and he believed in a system where people watched the thing alone. They put their head to a kinetoscope. They watched one by one. You watched alone. The Lumieres, who weren't really interested in the show business part of it, they were sort of photographer scientists. They believed you had to show it to an audience. You got a group of people in. Now, you know, that shaped the medium. People built theaters because of that, which had never existed. Everybody went to the movies. But then, 50 years pass, and the technology alters, and you have a box you can take home, and you can watch alone. And all of a sudden, what Edison saw in the nature of this thing comes to being. It's completely without plan and organization, but the technology has a sort of force of its own that will come through. And now, of course, we're in an age where going to the movies and watching with a crowd, with a group, is dying away. And the means by which you can watch things on your own are becoming more and more potent.
Yeah, then that's... It's interesting you say about that thing, the technology of the TV. Because if we want to take the box metaphor on, you know, the Pandora's box opens, first people have to go out. It's not a domestic thing. People have to leave the houses. They go and sit in the dark with other people and see this thing, and it awakens something in them. Then when you've got that happening in the corner of your living room, as you say, all the time, that's a... It's like domestic monsters or something. I don't know.
It's a completely different kind of beast. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. And it changes society, really. Because, I mean, for someone of my age, crowds to me meant going to soccer matches, standing in big crowds with my father sort of protecting me from the crush. Or going to a movie house, a theater, when you really had to stand in line, you had to queue to get in, because it was almost always packed. But that's what a crowd meant to me. And I was very conscious of the sort of group response. Everyone laughing, everyone afraid, everyone excited when someone scores a goal, that kind of thing. Now, these days, those kind of big communal experiences, they're not actually as common. There are rock concerts, and you would know better than I know, but the experience of being in the crowd is probably a lot more vital than hearing the music, because it's not a place you go to hear music in the sense that you can hear it at home.
No, I mean, in festivals, very often you can hardly hear anything because the wind blows
exactly.
the sound around.
It's being in the group, being in the crowd. Now, people don't do things in crowds in quite that way anymore, and that's fascinating, I think. Very interesting.
Somebody's coming to tell us off. Is somebody going to let...
Sorry, was that the door?
Somebody's knocking on the door, yeah.
That's Kurt.
They want to know whether we want tea or not.
Yeah, we could have a cup of tea.
No, I'm fine, I'm fine.
Yeah, I wanted to... The reason I wanted to speak to you about Gene Harlow is the room that we did some film in yesterday, room 29, is supposedly the room that she spent her honeymoon in 1932.
With Paul Byrne?
Yeah, who took his own life, I think, 2 months later or something.
Yes.
So, given that very happy story, can you... Tell me a bit about Jean Harlow. What was her kind of... I know her as a platinum blonde and this story about the fact that her husband killed herself. I don't really know her films that well.
Well, Jean Harlow was... she was one of the outstanding sex goddesses of talking pictures. I don't think she would have made it in silent pictures. Her voice, she had a very slangy, low-down attitude. And she actually always played and tried to seem a little more tramp-like than I think she was in her upbringing. And she formed an image which the hair was a vital part, bright blonde hair, voluptuous and very relaxed with it. She moved, we're talking about movement of people, she moved like someone very comfortable with her sexuality. Whether she was, in fact, I don't know. But that's the way she seemed on film. And she dressed in a provocative way, which came out of silent pictures. A lot of women in silent pictures, you can tell, are not wearing underwear. It increases the feeling of how thin they are, how slim they are. It was a very important aspect of films. But it also, it suggests a kind of sexual readiness. And she was like that. And she was probably in the early 30s the rawest, sexiest person on the American screen, and MGM, her studio, fashioned films for her that played to that, and she was frequently playing with Clark Gable, and he was a little rough too, so they were two of a kind. You get a film like Red Dust, which one of the best films they made together, where the chemistry seems very, very good, very strong. And she marries this man. You want to get into this? She marries this man, Paul Byrne, who was quite an important producer figure, very close to Irving Thalberg, who was really running MGM in terms of the production outfit. And it was not known, widely known, but Byrne had been married before. And they married, and it didn't work. There are various interpretations, one of which is that Byrne was either gay or physically unable to perform. And he may well have killed himself in a cottage up in the hills. Equally, there's the possibility that his first wife, having heard about this marriage, came down and shot him. And she was later found dead herself. No one really knows the definite answer. It was one of the great scandals of that era. And Harlow went on. She made several more films. She didn't die for some time after, 5 years or so afterwards. Died still very young herself, and really died because she didn't take any care of herself medically. Movie stars in those days did not understand wellness in the way that movie stars do today. You know, it was a quite different thing. They lived more dangerously, more recklessly, and Harlow did too.
And that's because nobody had done that before. Nobody had the opportunity to live that way before.
Yes, and also because health didn't have the place in the culture that it has now. You know, nobody thought to take care of themselves. There's a story about how in about 1956, Humphrey Bogart is at a party, and he's like late 50s, and he's coughing very badly. And Greer Garson is there, the actress, and she says, "You know, Bogie, that's a bad cough you've got." And he says, "Oh, I just cough, that's all." And she says, you should go see a doctor. And it's the cancer that will kill him within a year and a half. And movie stars today have access to doctors of many kinds. And they have ways of preserving their youth, which they think is vital, that are terrifying, you know. And that didn't happen once upon a time. And that's one reason why people on screen in those days look older than we're used to. They just didn't know how to take care of themselves.
One leads me on to another person who spent time here, Howard Hughes, who famously did get into health, but kind of went a little bit
off the deep end.
Too
yes.
far there.
Yes, yes.
Can you tell me a little bit about him?
Oh, well, where do we begin? Well, Hughes is, in so many ways, you can talk about him. He is an example of the rich kid who says, "I'd like to get into movies. I'd like to meet movie stars. I'd like to screw movie stars. I'd like to own movie stars. I'd like to make movies. I'm so rich, why not, you know?" The daughter of Larry Ellison, Megan Ellison, now, I don't think she's 30. She has a company called Annapurna Films. She's been behind some of the most important films in recent years. She just puts her own money into them. That idea of a very rich kid going to Hollywood and getting into movies, it's as current now as it was then. So that was one side of Hughes. Hughes was crazy about flying. Flying and female breasts. The iconography of his work, his career as a movie producer, is there. And I think it's fascinating. You know, people make jokes about Howard Hughes. And there's plenty to laugh at, but his films are actually pretty interesting. And flying in the movies, 20s, 30s, 40s, big subject. And Hughes was at the forefront of it. He takes over a studio, it doesn't last, and probably he goes crazy. But he is a mythic figure. As we speak, not many miles from here, Warren Beatty is at last playing Howard Hughes in a film, which he has wanted to make for decades, and now he's old enough to play Hughes. Don't know what it will be like, but, you know, there have been a lot of films about Hughes, and they will keep going on. He's a he's a very, very American character. And it all comes from a drilling head for oil that his father really perfected, that was vital to the oil industry, and he makes a fortune out of it and that. And I've talked to people who met Hughes, and they say that even as a sort of youngish man, he was dotty, neurotic and odd, but very smart and actually quite charming and interesting. Catherine Hepburn, I think, was very, very fond of him. Hughes was the man who paid for Catherine Hepburn to set up the Philadelphia story. And I don't know whether they had a sexual affair. I don't know that Catherine Hepburn ever had a sexual affair with a man in her life. But they were very close. They were very fond of each other. And I think people who knew Hughes in those years liked him, which isn't quite the image you get now, because we get this man who walks around with long hair, long fingernails, and
tissue boxes on the feet.
Yes, and stores his own urine and all that kind of thing. You know, stuff that we wouldn't like to be seen doing. But as a young man, he was quite something.
When you say it's a mythic story, I mean that's the.
It's a mythic story in the sense that no one now is ever going to know the facts. It's sort of America, even in this age of incredible information technology. America keeps generating stories you'll never know the answer to. Who killed Kennedy? We'll never know. But because we never know, we can go on dreaming about it, speculating, you know. What was Howard Hughes really like? Same kind of thing. What happened to Amelia Earhart? Same sort of thing. The stories that remain open-ended. There's something about those stories and their mythic force that means a lot in America.
Well, and also the myth of the person who, from outside, seems to have got everything.
Yes.
And in some ways, that
yes.
destroys them.
Well, and you know, in that way, he's a little bit like Citizen Kane. He's that kind of figure. He's the kid who becomes so wealthy you can't measure it. He can do anything he likes, and he dies alone. Hughes died in an aircraft. And if there's any place he would have chosen to die, it was in an aircraft, I'm sure.
We're almost at the end, you know.
I didn't know that. No one could tell me the script.
This is a slightly random one. You know, your radio series was called Life at 24 Frames Per Second.
Yes.
We are shooting at 24 frames per second, you'll be glad to know. But, you may not know the answer to this, but is there any reason they chose that? You know, why did they choose that frame rate? Were there experiments like with people doing different things? And do you know anything about how they kind of eventually settled on that?
Well, people made silent films. They shot them usually at 16 to 18 frames a second, because at 16 frames a second, you get what is called persistence of vision. If you show 16 still pictures in a second, people believe they're seeing live motion and time passing. If you get much below 16, there is a flicker effect. In other words, you begin to see the separation. 16, you don't. So 16 gives you visual continuity. But when you go to sound, the projector needs to do its job on the picture and the sound. And technically, they had to be the bulbs that read the two things needed to be a little farther apart, and they needed to go to 24 frames a second for that system to work. So 24 frames a second became, for decades, the standard form, and you know, it's still in the sense that frames going through a camera, which hardly ever happens anymore, but then you would still do that. Now, someone like Scorsese is a master at shooting at slightly different ratios, different shots, scenes. He might go to, say, 32. And between 24 and 32, there is a different effect. There is something like a slowing. When it's all projected at the same speed, there's something like a slowing, so that the shot, the moment, will look and feel, above all, it will feel distended or exaggerated or italicized. And Scorsese loves doing that. He's very good at doing it. Other people do it too, but you can vary the speed at which you shoot. And then when it's all projected at the same pace, suddenly the pacing in a film seems to alter a little bit. If you look at Raging Bull, in the fight scenes particularly, there are moments where he plays with the pacing like that, you know.
So it's not like extreme slow motion, it's just kind of taking the edge.
Extreme slow motion, you need to get to something like 64 frames a second, something, you know. And of course you can go far higher than that. It does not feel like what the audience calls slow motion. But you have slowed the motion a little. And what you've done in slowing the motion is allowing the feeling to take a little longer. So if you look at a movie closely, analyze it, you will see that it's got something quite significant to do with what you feel about it.
I'm going to finish with, could this be a summing up of what we've been talking about? There's a quote in Sunset Boulevard when it's Eric von Stroheim, isn't it?
Yes.
When he shows a silent film.
Yes.
Which I believe is one of his old films, Queen Kelly, a film that
Absolutely.
Wasn't finished.
Absolutely.
And Gloria Swanson's in that. It's a silent film, and she mouths some stuff, and then a title comes up. And yes. It says, "Cast out this wicked dream which has seized my heart."
Yes.
Is that the story of the movies? Is that what we should think? Or
it's a beautiful irony in Billy Wilder's film, and he was very good at ironies like that. No, it's not what you should think. I think, look, we dream. We know, I think, reliably, that we need to dream. That dreaming is, it regenerates the brain and it's vital to sleep. Sometimes we remember our dreams. So we wake up and for a few seconds or longer, the dream is very present. And sometimes we're disturbed by that. And traditionally, historically, people went to doctors like Sigmund Freud and said, "Doctor, I've been dreaming about this. What does it mean?" And he said, "Well, it means so-and-so, you know." And he didn't say the dream would go away. And I think probably the truth is that we, just as we look at movies and helplessly find meaning in them, I think we dream helplessly. It's a way we sort out what's been happening to us. And there's an element in it that is deliberate and dramatic, but there's an element that is random and automatic and chance. And in other words, I'd say, you've got to dream about something. So don't worry about casting the dream out, you know. I mean, it works beautifully in Sunset Boulevard. But the truth of the matter is, you're going to die, you want to be alive, and you're living with a struggle, an intellectual, emotional struggle between those two things. And it turns out that for about 100 years now, moving film has had a very profound effect upon that conflict in us. Sometimes it terrifies us, sometimes it puts us in a kind of heaven. And you probably can't have one without the other.
I think that's a great place to end this conversation. Thank you very much, Dan.
Thank you.
Thank you.